So go to the.
Let's start.
Okay, good morning, and it's a pleasure to have our Honorable Director General of CSIR, Dr. Shekhar Mande, and my colleagues, Dr. Alok Dhawan, Dr. Ranjana Agarwal, Dr. Mutkavi, and Dr. Sangwan, and all others. It's a great day for us because we are trying to have a program and the summer research training program. This is witnessing the lockdown situation in the educational institutes. We felt that a lot of our time is not utilized, and when the whole world is looking at scientists to come up with solutions, a large number of our young scientists are locked in their houses, and there is something that we can do. So based on that, on 1st June, we kick-started this program and gave a very short time, thinking that we will have a few hundred of people who can be trained. But there's an overwhelming response of more than 16,000 people who have applied. And this is a little difficult for us to accommodate because it's way beyond our expectation. However, we thought that we will go outside CSIR and try to find out the ways of accommodating. Currently, around 730 people are connected in MS Teams. Around 300 plus people are connected on Facebook. And we are expecting that every minute this number is increasing. And based on the suggestion of our Director General, Dr. Shekhar Mande, I have taken this responsibility along with six other colleagues who are the directors of other labs, and a strong team of 20 people in NIST Jorhat to initiate the online applications for summer. And we have put the deadline as 5th, and then it was extended to 8th because there were several requests. The objective of this program is to provide a scientifically stimulating platform to the students and teachers stuck at home due to lockdown, and expose them to scientific research and inculcate scientific temperament in our own small way. The motto, as I said before, when the world is in lockdown and universities and education institutes are closed, we need to proactively create opportunities to engage and connect students and teachers to bring forth innovativeness and creativity to combat COVID-19 types of pandemics through science and technology. And I feel that when you look at the history, most of the inspiring innovations were made only at the time of war or natural disasters or pandemics. So when a tough challenge is here, the best in us should come out. And just like a Pokhran test has given a challenge for our nation, this COVID-19 has also given a challenge, and country has been really able to rediscover themselves in some areas of science and technology. And CSIR, under the leadership of our Director General, has played an extremely, extremely important part in building this. So, next. The agenda of the outline of the programs is, we would like to inspire people by bringing the topmost personalities, like the popular lectures, where a large number of people can join. And this involves the topmost people in India and maybe some selected Nobel laureates from abroad. We're trying to connect to 30 plus minus people in India and 30 people from abroad. So we are targeting about 60 people, maybe 30, 40 lectures we will be successful in the next 2 months, and we are very positive about it. Besides that, there will be specialized lectures in each subject by experts. And the feature is live demonstrations of high-end equipments, instruments, and experimental procedures will be described by the experts while they are carrying out it. And these things will be for a selected small number of people who are involved. So there will also be lectures on fundamental, applied, and translational research topics. And if someone wants to get clarity about the basics and fundamentals, we will try to connect them to the experts, and then people can ask questions, and there will be a box where people can ask questions, and we will also have every day some time where experts will answer the people either through MS Teams or Facebook Live or YouTube, Facebook Live or MS Teams or other means. And I would like to bring all of you to your kind notice that this is definitely not an online lecture series. This is a full-fledged research training program, because we feel that we have to interact with each mentor, will interact with each student. So we try our best to not to reduce it to a series of online lecture classes, but it is a research training program. So each student is mentored individually, and this is very important. Next slide. So we, all of you know that this, these are the slides that we have for the students as well as mentors. Mentors, so far we have 400 people outside CSIR system who have registered, and we also have acceptance from another 400 people who are really eminent personalities. So 800 people have agreed to mentor people outside CSIR. As this particular initiative has started only recently, 3 days before, we might easily be able to get around 2000 mentors. In a country of over a billion population, it should not be a problem if you have a strong will. We strongly believe that where there is a will, there is a way, and we will be able to connect the needy mentors, the needy students with the capable mentors. So this is a mandate. Next. So when we looked at the applications, one immediate thing is whether we can give it to only a selected number of people, because the capacity is not very high. So actually we try to look at each of these applications, which is a Herculean task, and at NIST Jorhat we took the responsibility of taking around 2500 students, and we categorized them into group A, group B, group C, group D, where it's not that group A people are better than group B. We just categorized, and then there is a possibility to shift from one group to another group. But this is a classification that we are doing in NIST Jorhat, and other labs and other mentors can also have their own ways of looking at things. And besides the regular projects that one has with a mentor, the common things are we will be conducting quizzes, essay writing, slogan writing. If you take an emblem, a theme, we will try to have a challenge for taking an emblem and writing some small projects, and most importantly, asking questions and asking right questions. And we will also try to see if we can. Try to see if we can reward people who will do these things in a very effective way. And how about looking at grand challenges? Recognizing grand challenges and providing training or providing solutions for these grand challenges is also another thing that we would like to bring it to the notice. And how do we get unique ideas? And the mechanism to reward these unique ideas is also on part of our agenda. We are actually driven more by our enthusiasm, and if there are so many lacunas, and then there are so many problems that are there in running it, because our lab is not fully equipped with the bandwidth. So I would like to bring to the notice of all of you that on 28th May, around just after noon, we got a letter from our Honorable Director General, and we made the advertisement because he has been in touch with me for 2-3 days before that. And the advertisement was sent on the same day, and the creation of this online portal was started, and we could put it from 1st June on available to everybody after checking the functioning of it. And by 8th June was the deadline. And our people have worked so hard for 2 days, and then give the results of these people by 10th. and the scrutinization and then allotment of the application is still going on with several research laboratories, CSIR laboratories, and all our sister laboratories have played a very important role. They are very, very enthusiastic. And total number of applications that are received are 16,384. Online applications are 12,884. Offline are 3,500. And a small percentage are redundant. They applied more than once. So if you round off, still it is around 16,000 applications. And we are now in the process of allocating the mentors for the remaining people. About 30-40% of the people we have finished the job. And by 18th evening, we will be able to find out how many people can be, all the people who are the mentors for each candidate, this will be available. Then we would like to conduct the orientation programs and a couple of lectures tomorrow and day after. And by 18th evening, we will try to have a link between the mentee and the mentor. So currently, we have 866 people in the MS teams and 869 and 410 people on Facebook Live. And I really thank all of you, and particularly the brilliant idea that our DG has to do something in this COVID times, and the support that I get from Dr. Mutkavi, Dr. Alok Dhawan, Dr. Ranjana, Dr. Sangwan, and Dr. Chakravarti is tremendous. Now, I request Professor Alok Dhawan, Director, IITR, to introduce today's speaker of eminence, Dr. Shekhar G. Mande, the Director General and Secretary, DSIR. Over to Dr. Alok Dhawan.
Very good morning to all of you who are on MS Teams or on Facebook. I think it's a very unique experiment that CSIR is conducting now, and we are in the midst of this COVID pandemic, and we have to improvise all the time. It's a great pride and privilege for me to introduce his Speaker of Eminence, Dr. Shekhar Mande, who is not only the Director General and Secretary of CSIR, but he is a brilliant scientist himself, a visionary leader. He led the NCCS Pune as a director, but also worked as a scientist in CDFD. And before that, he started his career with CSIR as a scientist in IMTEC, Chandigarh. He has, to his credit, most of the awards that are bestowed on young scientists, including the Shanti Srup Bhatnagar Prize and the Wellcome Trust Award. And he's a fellow of all the Indian academies, as well as several awards that he has been bestowed from abroad. I think he is heading currently, if I may use the word, the citadel of scientists who are doing innovative research. That's what I call CSIR now. He has transformed CSIR after he joined, and especially in these times of COVID-19, he galvanized everyone, the entire team of CSIR, through the different themes. It could be engineering, it could be biology, it could be physics, it could be any science that we are involved in. We're all galvanized into this this pandemic, tried to do our best in whichever way we could to ensure that the government and the people are benefited by the science and technology that is being developed at CSIR. So I think with these very few words, I will invite Professor Shekhar C. Mande to deliver his address and enlighten us more about the prospects of CSIR and how we intend doing research in this era. Dr. Mande, please.
Thank you, Alok, so much for your kind words. Before I start, I must place on record my deep appreciation to the entire team led by Dr. Narahari Shastri, who have done such a phenomenal job of putting things together in such a short notice for conducting the Summer Research Training Program 2020. As was correctly pointed out, we are living in a very challenging times, and the real human spirit of innovation comes out in such challenging times. Narahari Shastri very correctly pointed it out that most of our innovations and creativity really comes to the fore in times such as this. I would like to compliment the entire team, Dr. Naresh Shastri, Dr. Ranjan Agarwal, Dr. Alok Dhawan, Dr. Mudkavi, Rishi Chakravarti, and everyone else who is involved in these efforts of attracting as many as 16,000 applications is phenomenal in such a short notice. That also is a reflection of the fact that how vibrant is our new generation. So younger generation of scientists who are actually hungry for knowledge, and despite the fact that the country is going through a lockdown, the country is going through an extraordinarily challenging time, all the people have risen and shown that they are indeed hungry for the knowledge. So I welcome all of you to this particular program, and let us see, in next about half an hour, I would like to try to present to you three different aspects. One aspect is how creative our population has been in our geographical area over centuries. The second aspect is post-independence, how CSIR emerged as a leading S&T organization of the country and how it has led country on the path of development on all fronts. And the third aspect is what CSIR is doing even today in the challenging times. So these are the three things that I would like to put forth before you for consideration. My PowerPoint slides are available as PDF, and Dr. Naresh Shastri would actually be happy to make this available to anyone of you who would like to have a look at them. What I would like to actually start from ancient times, and for the fact that many of us have been taught in our history that science and technology was kind of non-existent in our country until the foreign powers arrived here. And we were actually told that all the developments of the modern development that what we talk of essentially happened because of the arrival of some of the foreign powers in our country. And that is a wrong notion. That part of history needs to be corrected. What we actually should be proud that human beings, in whichever environment they live in, they are always very curious, and in whichever corner of the world they live, they are always very innovative, and we are no exception. The people who have lived in our geography have been no exception in their innovations, in their probing of the nature and asking the questions and making sure that society benefits by the innovations that they have had in their mind. The very fact that we have had a very long tradition of settlements in our continent actually reflects that particular fact that people living in this continent have been extraordinarily innovative. And I want to just give you two or three different examples before I come to the post-independent development. The first of the examples is this. And in fact, only 2 days ago, there's a paper which came in Science, a journal called Science, which showed that as early as 48,000 years ago, there is an evidence of people using bows and arrows in Sri Lanka. And similar evidences, also archaeological evidences, exist in India that people have been actually using tools for their own purpose, for their own living, even as long ago as about 50,000 years ago. Now, this is a very brilliant example of this particular statue. This is about 5,000 years ago from the Harappan civilization, what we call. And it shows that even 5,000 years ago, people knew how to blend metals. People knew how to cast metals. And they knew how to use something called a loss wax technology, which is used even today to make statues of metals and this and that. So actually, it's a brilliant fact, brilliant example that even 5,000 years ago, people had actually found out a loss wax technology and blending and casting of metal. It's a fantastic example that how people have been very innovative in their own manifestation of their own thoughts and other aspects. In terms of society, how it benefits society directly is another brilliant example of innovation. Now, this innovation has existed since about 7th century AD. And if you go across India in the hilly regions, in the foothills of Himalayas, you start from Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Sikkim, and the Northeast. Across the entire belt of the foothills of Himalayas, you find presence of something called a gharat. What's a gharat? Those of you who have had chance to go to these regions, you will see that wherever there are water streams coming down the mountains, these water streams have been used as flour mills. So from 7th century AD, we actually have designed very sophisticated gear system by which a flour mill can be generated. A wheel on the top rotates. You put wheat into that and out comes wheat flour. You know, it's fantastic. This is much before electricity operated power mills have been generated. And in the rest of the country, people actually used to do it by hand. And those of you remember your grandmothers and all, many people had it at home where wheat flour used to be made by grinding manually at home, but not in the foothills of Himalayas. There, the energy from the water which was flowing down was used in the gharats, and it's a fantastic example. 7th century AD, you know, it's about 1300 years ago, this technology was developed by our own people in our own geography. Now the question comes, how does the state support science and technology and such kind of innovations? Whosoever is in power, whether it's a king or an emperor or a democracy, the job of the state is essentially to promote such kind of innovations and support science and technology-led development. And what do people do? People do very simple things. They implement the policies suggested by scientists and technologists. And let me give you one example from 1st century AD. This is an example from 1st century AD, roughly about 2000 years ago. The Chola kings then, in the southern part of India, generated this dam on the Kaveri River. And today, if you go there, near Trichy, it's called Kallanai Dam, is still in use. And in fact, it so happens, there's the oldest dam in the history that is still in use today across the world. Around the world is the oldest dam still in use, made in 1st century AD. And the dam had major purpose of providing irrigation to the farmers. And that's exactly where the state steps in. The Chola kings actually recognize the fact that farming is an essential activity, and to provide irrigation to the farmers is actually an important aspect. And therefore, the Chola kings drafted in the technologies of that generation to make this kind of dam. It's absolutely marvelous example of a dam that was made. And as all of us know, that agriculture was a very thriving activity even then in our country. In fact, if you look at India's history, there are many, many such examples that we can go on giving. For example, in mathematics, in astronomy, in metallurgy, and also in medicines. We can talk of many different things. Today in the corona times, we are talking of vaccines. And many of us know that vaccines have existed in India as a practice which was followed from 12th century AD, what is called as the Tika practice. It was followed by the learned people of Banaras who would traverse across the country and vaccinate people just ahead of the monsoon. You know, this practice has been very prevalent. So if you are told that vaccination came because of the knowledge that the Europeans brought here, I think it's not fully correct. Probably it was right that Edward Jenner for the first time showed from the modern science perspective how vaccination actually happens or how vaccination should be done. But the practice existed even before that as the Tika practice. So we should be very proud that the people living in this era have been very innovative and had adopted science and technology as an essential component of the development of human beings. We should be proud of another fact that when we became independent in 1947, our forefathers clearly saw science and technology as the major driver of development. And ours is a very unique constitution, and we must thank our forefathers and the people who wrote our constitution that they hardwired in our contribution, in our constitution. H is what you see of Article 51A, which says to develop the scientific temper, humanism, and a spirit of inquiry and reform. This is hardwired in our constitution. And we should be very, very proud of our people who wrote our constitution to make sure that science and technology and spirit of inquiry is a part of our national constitution. I would like to give you the examples of modern India. What were the challenges when the British left us? I would just like to highlight a fact that when the British arrived here in the form of East India Company, somewhere in the mid 18th century, at that time, the country was a very, very prosperous country. Many of us know that the total GDP that we contributed to the world was of the order of about 27% of world GDP was contributed by India at that time. When the British left us in 1947, our contribution had dropped down to about 2%, because essentially all the industry, all the manufacturing had moved out of India, and therefore our contribution was very low. And in fact, we were left as a very poor nation. We were deprived of almost everything that we could think of. So the major challenge for the people of the generation that went by, the major challenge behind before them was how do we resurrect our country using science and technology as the major driver. And therefore, we can actually look at rough period starting from 1950s. There was a period of self-reliance. Then came the period of 70s to 1990s of technology denial era, in which every possible technology around the world was denied to India because the world was scared that India would become a superpower one day using these technologies. But that's not to be. We want to be a superpower as far as science and technology is concerned, but we are an extremely peaceful nation, as our history tells us, for last 5,000 years. We don't have geographical ambitions, and we have very peace-loving ideas that have emerged from our countries. People like Gautam Buddha and people like Mahatma Gandhi were born and were the epistles of peace around the world of their own era. The eras of 1990s to about 2000 was an era in which we became aware of intellectual property, and I'll comment about a little bit about it later. And now today is an era in which we have globalized ourselves, and we have to see how we become Atmanirbhar, as the Honorable Prime Minister has said, in today's era, how do we actually move forward with Atmanirbharta? And CSIR has in its genes the Atmanirbharta always built in from its beginning. As I said, when we began our journey in 1947, one of the first challenges ahead of us was how are we going to implement the democracy in our country. We had adopted democracy as a form of governance, and democracy's essential principle is that how do we ensure that every citizen gets a right to exercise his or her vote. And CSIR came up with a very, very innovative solution. What you see on the forefinger of the Honorable Prime Minister here is an ink that was developed by CSIR Laboratory, National Physical Laboratory, and then the technology was transferred to Mysore Ink, and this ink is now used in many countries around the world, including in India. You know, every time you go and vote in the elections, please remember that the ink was developed by CSIR Laboratory in 1950s in order to implement democracy. And those who would like to have an even better example, a better known example to all of you, is someone here. Look at this. Even the celebrities actually show what CSIR has done in implementing the democracy in the country. There are a whole lot of other challenges that we are facing, and CSIR contributed very, very richly to each of these. During the Green Revolution, one of the challenges was how are we going to mechanize the revolution, mechanize the agriculture. And CSIR took upon itself the part of mechanization of agriculture and produced the first tractor in the country. You know, the tractors were not available then, and agriculture was essentially practiced through bullock carts and through manual means. But CSIR took upon the challenge of mechanizing everything, and what we see result is that many agri-pesticides were developed by our laboratories then to implement Green Revolution and see its benefits for common people. But then CSIR also did many other wonderful things. The entire emergence of pharmaceutical industry in the country, especially the generic pharma in 1970s and 1980s, is CSIR's direct role in the development of nation. Some of you may remember in 1980s, probably the era before many of you were born, there were another very dreaded disease was sweeping across the planet called a human immune deficiency virus, or HIV, which causes the disease AIDS or acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. And the real fear was that it is going to sweep across the planet and going to affect a large population. A number of companies devised drugs against it, essentially from the West. However, these drugs were extraordinarily costly and had to be made available at an affordable price to countries like India. And CSIR took upon itself to make these drugs affordable and transferred the technologies to a number of countries. And companies such as Cipla then started producing these drugs and supplied to the entire African subcontinent. And that's how actually drugs became very, very affordable in the 1980s. When somebody filed a patent on haldi in United States, CSIR took upon itself to go and fight that patent. You know, haldi is a traditional knowledge of India. For generations, people have used haldi. Some of you might remember, when you have running nose or if you have sour throat, your mother or your grandmother gives you hot milk mixed with haldi and jaggery. This is a very common remedy in India. And haldi is known to have protective properties on many of such kind of disorders. This is known. but someone in US filed a patent on it. And what it would mean? Therefore, using haldi for any medicinal properties, we would pay some money as royalty to that particular company. But CSIR, recognizing this fact, filed a suit in United States and very successfully fought a patent, and the patent was eventually revoked. That's one of the greatest contributions of CSIR in modern era. Similarly, creation of jobs from leather industry has also been fantastic and fascinating story that we can talk some other day. More recently, CSIR has been working very close to the farmers. This is one of the rice varieties that CSIR has developed. The Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology in Hyderabad, in collaboration with some of the ICAR institutes and with support from DBT and CSIR, has developed a variety of Sambar Masuri. What you can see on the right hand side, the rice which is not Sambar Masuri, which is blight resistant, you can see the yellow top on that, that is affected by the blight. While in the front towards us, what you see is the green rice, that is actually resistant rice, and that has been developed by CSIR. And on today's date, about 2 lakh hectare land is under cultivation for this particular rice in 7 different states of India. We expect that about 10 to 20 lakh hectare will come under cultivation in the coming few years. Another great example I want to actually tell you very quickly is a very recent example, only 1 year old example. That is, in the alcohol industry, which uses sugarcane as one of the major form as a distillery to generate ethanol. On the right hand side at the bottom, you see what comes out as an effluent is what we call as spent wash. Now, ethanol industry is a very thriving industry in the country. About 50 million people and families in India are dependent on it. About 5 million hectares is under cultivation for the sugarcane in the country. And about 80,000 crore is the annual turnover of this particular one. But the spent wash is extraordinarily polluting. You cannot discharge it into water. You cannot discharge in ground. And our lab in Bhavnagar, at the Central Salt and Marine Chemical Research Institute, or CSMCRI, came up with this particular solution. They took spent wash, extracted organics out of it, what you see on the left, and the organics can now be used as animal feed. Then as you move towards right, the inorganics are now extracted in terms of potassium nitrate. And all of you know that potassium nitrate is a very good fertilizer. And therefore, we can actually extract two aspects out of spent wash. One is the organics that go as cattle feed, and the inorganics, which are potassium and all, which can be used as fertilizers in agriculture. What remains is pure water that can be used back once again. So what it has actually enabled us is that it has created about 15,000 new jobs by using this technology, and it is environmentally friendly, and the water can now be circulated. So it's a perfect example of what we call today as circular economy. And it's a very recent example, as I said, what CSIR has been contributing very significantly to our society. The other example that I want to give you before I hang up is that of our successful aroma mission. And I would encourage you to go to this particular video to show how farmers across the country have been benefited by the aroma mission of CSIR in recent times. Much of the land that this farming has been done is non-cultivable land. The land cannot be actually used for cultivating other crops, but aroma crops can actually be grown there very easily. And our laboratories have actually gone and helped the farmers to generate aromatic plants there. But not only that, they have also installed distillation units there so that the farmer can get economic value out of it. And on Twitter, this particular link that I have shown you here shows you how it has brought benefit to large amount of farmers, large number of farmers in the state of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. It's a fantastic example that how CSIR has brought so much value to the farmers through our aroma mission. The last example that I want to talk to you about is the coronavirus. All of us recognize that we are passing through an extraordinary situation. It is unbelievable that 6 months ago, we could have imagined that we cannot get out of our house easily. We cannot imagine that you have to work from home. We cannot imagine that college and school examinations were postponed. We cannot imagine that so many people have been locked inside their houses. It was impossible to imagine 6 months ago, but in the world changed at a stroke as we were entering the new year. A cluster of people in China was seen to have symptoms which are like pneumonia, and it was ascribed to a new virus that emerged, what is called as the severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2 or SARS-CoV-2, which causes this particular disease that is now sweeping across the planet at this moment. There's a new challenge for scientists and technologists around the world. What would people do in India? CSIR recognized that this is going to be a global pandemic in early March. Just as about WHO was in the process of declaring this as a global pandemic, CSIR team, the entire CSIR team came together and devised a strategy of coronavirus mitigation. And I'm very proud that all the CSIR labs have risen to the occasion of this mitigation process of coronavirus. The country, we did not make any PPEs in the countries before the coronavirus came here. CSIR rose to the occasion and started making PPEs. On today's date, the technology that we have given to a company in Bangalore makes about 30,000 PPEs per day. The country was extremely short of ventilators. On today, that's not going to be the case. Our lab in Bangalore, the National Aerospace Laboratory, has made a prototypic ventilator, and many companies have come forward to commercialize this. Very soon, that is in another 15 days, you will see the ventilators made by CSIR in the market. Oxygen is premium. People who undergo the severe symptoms of the disease find themselves that they are short of oxygen. Our laboratory in Pune, the National Chemical Laboratory, has made an oxygen enrichment unit. Hospitals are going to be in short. In fact, isolation wards are going to be in short. Our two laboratories, the Central Building Research Institute in Roorkee and a Structural Engineering Research Center in Chennai, both of them have come forward with solutions. They can go and very quickly make 1,000-bedded hospitals in any city in a matter of only a few days. It's amazing. The diagnostics today is only based on RT-PCR, and 15 of our labs are actively engaged, including the IITR, which is led by Dr. Alok Dhawan here, and NIST Jorhat, which is led by Dr. Narari Shastri here. Both these labs, along with 13 other labs of CSIR, are involved actively in the diagnostics. But a diagnostic test today is what we call as the RT-PCR, but CSIR has come forward with new methods of diagnosis, more accurate, more quicker, and more affordable. All these tests are actually very accurate, quick, and they're affordable. And these tests would be in the field very soon now. CSIR got a large number of candidates in clinical trials, whether be it MW, whether be it certain drugs like favipiravir, or whether be in certain other formulations, plant derived formulations or Ayush formulations. CSIR was very quick in initiating clinical trials in collaboration with some of the major companies in the country. And last but not the least, when the world was saying that hydroxychloroquine is not very effective in coronavirus mitigation, there's a paper which was published in the journal Lancet, a very, very prestigious journal. From the people, from the professors in Harvard University, CSIR took upon itself to show that this paper was faulty, and the pressure that was built upon Lancet, where in which CSIR participated, it was a global pressure that was built upon Lancet, eventually paper had to be withdrawn. As all of you know, one of the major producers of hydroxychloroquine is India. And if this paper had withstood the scrutiny of all the scientific community, probably hydroxychloroquine would not have been used in coronavirus mitigation. We are hopeful that hydroxychloroquine is a very good prophylactic drug, and we are hopeful that the world will recognize that as prophylaxis, the drug could be used against coronavirus. And therefore, India could once again play a very critical role in the mitigation of coronavirus. That's not actually what we are doing. And perhaps during the next course of next few weeks, if the summer training is really going on well, and if enthusiasm remains, we can come back and talk issues related to coronavirus and what CSIR has done. And many of our scientists in the CSIR system would be very delighted to tell you about what CSIR has done. Now, that's all that actually I had to say. Before I hang up, I would just like to leave you with this particular thought. These are the seven deadly sins that Mahatma Gandhi had proposed to us. And look at the sin number 5. It says that one should never practice science without humanity. Manata ke bina vikas sochna ye gambhir paap. And therefore, we must inculcate in ourselves the particular fact, those of us who want to be scientists, or technologies or engineers in future, we must inculcate in our minds that human face is the front face of science, and therefore when we practice science, we must be humans first and make sure that we have empathy for other human beings as much as what we have for everyone else. Thank you all very much for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Actually, there are so many questions, and actually one person called Shweta who asked how exactly should we answer the questions as we are all muted. So Ms. Shweta, we are able to see your questions in the live events of Q&A, and definitely if you have any question, you please type in the way you have asked this particular question. There are several questions. One Yashwant Manuvada has asked, how do we CSIR help if I wanted to develop an artificial immunogen that can fight SARS-CoV or other SARS type of viruses? So this was a question by a young person.
So artificial immunogens are the ones which would boost human immunity, right? I mean, there are different arms of human immune system, and we would like to actually boost a one particular arm which can fight the virus, right? And one should also boost the antibodies that are generated against the virus, the neutralizing antibodies. How does one do that? And there are multiple ways that people are trying around the world in this. In CSIR, what we have done, we have taken the route of an immune boosting drug or a vaccine, you may call, and that is called MW. Now, MW is a Mycobacterium indicus prenae. It's a bacterium, and it's a hit-kill bacterium. It specifically induces what is called as the Th1 arm of immune system. There's the immune system arm which specifically fights the invading pathogens, bacteria and viruses and so on and so forth. At the same time, it suppresses Th2, the ones which is very non-specific. And therefore, we believe that things like MW would be very useful. But if there are other ideas, and if those ideas seem to be viable, CSIR scientists would be very interested in looking at those, and CSIR can actually take up trials on some of those ideas as well.
Thank you very much, sir. Yashwant, you can make a small concept and then send it to us, and we will connect it to the right people. So there is a question by Kamran Khan, who is asking how temperature affects the coronavirus rate of spread.
Okay. So as of now, there is not much evidence whether temperature or humidity have much effect on the coronavirus. We don't know at what temperatures the virus survives or does not survive. It is obvious that if you heat it up to, let us say, 90 degrees or 100 degrees, it probably will not survive. But the common environmental temperatures that we live in winters, say in India, roughly from 20 degrees Celsius, in summers to roughly about 45 degrees Celsius, the virus doesn't seem to have much adverse effect on its survivability. And therefore, we should not hype on the fact, depend upon the fact that the virus would be killed by rising temperatures in summer. There is no evidence as of now whether the virus infections would be less in summer and more in winter or anything like that.
Thank you very much. And one person called Mr. Ashok is asking, we can include the computer-aided drug design also as a part of our dry lab experiments. And we are already including that and many other computational ones. And there were a number of questions that are raised, and like questions like, my name is there in the first list and now it is not there, by Harikishan B. Harikrishnan, please, your name will be included, and then if you have any doubt, you can write to us, and our team will be working on this, so that if you have any questions, if your name, if you have registered before 8th June, in the presence of everybody, I assure you that we will be able to include you as a one of the student in the SRTP program. There were a large number of questions, sir, where they were asking some small doubts or about the technical details, which we will be addressing during the orientation programs. If anybody has a very important technical question, you can type it in the question answers, and we will be able to answer that. So may I request Dr. Ranjana Agarwal, if she has something to say, because she is also one of the persons involved as a message to the.
Thank you, Dr. Shastri. First of all, I would like to thank our DG, Dr. Shekhar C. Mande, for motivating the CSIR for taking this summer research internship program, and Dr. Shastri for working so hard. And we are really overwhelmed with the 16,000 students participating. And I would like to assure the participants, like, the whole team is working. And we'll be working on connecting the mentors and the mentees, and making the groups where the maximum benefit can be achieved to the students. This is a new experiment, new learning for CSIR also. I think the candidates will be highly benefited with this exercise. Because we are having experts from not only from CSIR, from other institutes also. So there will be close networking, and will ensure that there is connectivity between the mentor and mentees, and it's not only a lecture series kind of program, like true internship experience the students will be getting. And they will be getting the first-hand experience with the new equipments, the latest equipments, and though it's an online program, but our effort will be that the learning is real learning. It's not only you know, the virtual learning. So that's what I would like to assure. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ranjana. So there are some more questions, and one question is, is it true that ashwagandha helps to create medicine for COVID-19?
Okay, so ashwagandha is one of the well-known formulations in Ayurveda biology, and CSIR is currently testing the hypothesis that it might help, but we'll have to wait for the results. And what CSIR has started is clinical trials based on ashwagandha. And the results of the clinical trials, so the clinical trials have been designed from very modern perspective, just the way the modern clinical trials are conducted. And only the results will tell. We'll have to wait for a few weeks before the results are out.
So Shubham Chatterjee is asking a question, that what is the role of mathematical modeling in predicting the behavior and spread of coronavirus pandemic?
So mathematical modeling is extremely useful in how coronavirus might spread. You know, so basically what you could do, you could take all the known data that you have. For example, we know that coronavirus essentially spreads through aerosols. When you inhale aerosols from an infected person, there's a chance that those aerosols entrapped coronavirus in that particular person, and therefore the unaffected person is now inhaling those aerosols. That's the significant evidence for that. Now, mathematical models can actually now go on in trying to suggest that where are coronavirus infected people, where are the clusters of people who are infected, what is the density of population there, what is the likelihood that these people might have transmitted coronavirus to the unaffected people, and so on and so forth. And based on that, some predictions can be made. And around the world, people are actually trying to make this kind of predictions on the data and the parameters that go into this kind of mathematical models. The mathematical models do indeed help. In many cases, they are very revealing, and they also help actually the decision-making authorities on how do we actually segregate people and keep them away, those who are infected.
Yeah. Dr. Anjali Priyadarshini from SRM University asking, is my study on certain herbal concoction developed would be useful for the human?
So as of now, there is not a good coronavirus mouse model. Although there is a report of one mouse model which is called as ACE2 knock-in mouse, in which coronavirus infects. So, but mouse model is not available yet in India, this particular mouse model, or rather is being made available only now. So one would have to actually use this particular mouse which gets affected by SARS-CoV-2 and then test whether any of the herbal productions are useful there. But if the herbal formulations are already known to be safe for human consumption, then one could even actually design clinical trials, human clinical trials around them.
Okay, thank you, sir. So from Facebook also there were several questions, and my colleague was bringing some Tejasvi Khadke as a question that is that Ayurvedic medicine will help coronavirus patients who are positive will be negative after taking that.
No. So I mean all the medicines, whether Ayurvedic or allopathic, would be given to people who are affected. In fact, Ayurvedic medicines can also be given to people who are not yet affected by the coronavirus and try to make their immune system slightly stronger, right? But if one is affected by the virus, then obviously the job of the medicine to make that person is a negative of awareness. So basically, either kill the virus in the host, that is in our body, selectively go and kill the virus, that's the job of a medicine to do, or improve the immunity of the host so that our body itself can fight on them. And Ayurvedic medicines can actually work probably, I mean, in a hypothesis, they can work very well on the second part of this particular aspect. They can boost human immunity so that the body can fight the virus effectively.
Pawan Kadve has an interesting question. Is there any special secret projects run by CSIR? How can I join them?
CSIR does not run any secret project. What you probably are driving at is there's something called strategic labs, to which some of the other sectors in the government, they work on those as a strategic sector. But CSIR belongs to the non-strategic sector, and therefore we don't work on any secret project. All that we do is a public knowledge, and our objective essentially only is to bring benefit to human beings through science and technology. That's what CSIR does.
One anonymous person writes, I wish if we could build a corridor among public, government and scientific institutes like CSIR to develop the scientific temperament of people in order to cure our environment.
That's a good thought. And what the job of all of us here, all the students who have joined and my colleagues here, is essentially to inculcate scientific temper amongst people. You know, I mean, we always say that trust science. What scientists tell you, please trust them. And science always tells you what is known today. Right? I mean, science doesn't tell you make predictions for tomorrow. What is known today might actually slightly differ tomorrow, because I mean, science is like that. It is continuously evolving. But if you trust science, it will be actually a good idea to do that, because that is our best bet for mitigating any of the situation that arises out of natural calamities or whichever.
So there are a large number of... There are a large number of questions in Facebook, and the scientists who is looking at Facebook would like to put forward those questions. I am giving it to you.
Sure.
Sir, one question from Rohit Kapila. So he is asking, is immunosystem is only the key to treat with COVID-19?
No, come again, immune system is what?
Immune system is the only key to treat with COVID-19.
Well, I mean, the human body is an amazing body, has immune arms, and essentially we divide into two kind of immune this thing. We don't need to go into details because there are not too many biologists probably in the audience. But something called cell-mediated immunity and something called humoral-mediated immunity and all. We're not going into that. But the body is amazingly capable of recognizing what it makes on its own, that is the self, and what comes from outside, that is the non-self. And if the non-self actually appears to be dangerous, then body launches a very coordinated immune attack on that particular thing. Typically pathogens such as viruses, bacteria, parasites, fungi, they are non-self and they actually try to invade our body and take over some of the functions of the body, just like coronavirus. And therefore, body's immune system job is essentially protect ourselves from these invading pathogens. And immune system, therefore, is the real defense of the body against any of the invasion from outside.
Rajesh Kumar Prasad asked a question. Is CSIR working on antibodies extraction from the corona treated patients?
Yes, CSIR is indeed working on two aspects from corona recovered patients. One is about what is called as a convalescent plasma, that people who have recovered from corona are a very good source of antibodies in their plasma. And our lab in Calcutta, the Indian Institute of Chemical Biology, has tied up with some of the hospitals in Calcutta, and they're trying to see whether this convalescent plasma can be used as a therapy. And test trials have begun already, and we're very happy with the outcome of the trial till now. The second thing that we are also trying to do are we are trying to extract antibodies out of the plasma and trying to see which of these antibodies are neutralizing antibodies against the virus. And this project has been funded as a public-private partnership, and we are hopeful that they will be successful in generating what are called as monoclonal antibodies from the recovered patients.
Sir, can you take one more question or two more questions?
Sure. Yeah, sure.
At what position is India in creating a vaccine against COVID-19?
So, vaccine, there are about 100 odd vaccine projects going on around the world that many of you would be aware of. The leading vaccine programs, for example, there is a company called Moderna in US. They are mRNA-based vaccine, the messenger RNA-based vaccine. Or there is a company in China called CanSino. They are using a vaccine based on an adenovirus vector, based on the spike protein, and so on and so forth. In India also, some of the companies have joined these efforts. Some of the largest vaccine makers around the world are thankfully in India, and these companies are working with academia around the world. For example, a Pune-based company, Serum Institute, has tied up with Oxford University, and they are actually trying to test this Oxford vaccine candidate and see whether it can be useful. CSIR has its own effort on vaccines. As I said, MW is the thing that what we have started already. But convalescent plasma or the antibody-based thing, also CSIR has started work on that.
Dipankar Nath has a question that is there any evidence that COVID-19 virus utilizes human cholesterol for their replication?
Well, we don't know much about that yet. What we are sure is the virus enters the body using ACE2 as the receptor. It enters our cells using ACE2 as the receptors, but there are other co-receptors that are also there. For example, mannose binding lectin and all. And once it enters the cells, it starts replicating its own, using its own RNA-dependent RNA polymerase and makes copies of its own. Whether it uses cholesterol as a source of carbon, it's not very well known as of now. Although people are thinking around the world that it might, but I don't think there is any unequivocal evidence has emerged yet, to my knowledge, that cholesterol is being used as a source of carbon.
One question that CSIR is working under your leadership is, had the coronavirus mutated in India already? That is a question by Akash Chaudhary.
Well, the answer is emphatic no. What we see is a dominant clade in India. In the pharyngeal tree, if you actually look at one particular branch, which has maximum of Indian strains, and they are still early days because we have sequenced about 500 to 600 viral isolates from India. We will have to actually answer this question better once we have sequenced something like 20,000 odd sequences. But 500-600 sequences what we have on our hand, it appears that there is a clade called C3i, if I'm not wrong, that appears to be dominant in India, and that seems to have emerged from Southeast Asia. So as of now, there is no evidence that there is any India-specific mutation that has emerged in coronavirus. So it's too early to talk about it, but at this moment, it does not appear to be a possibility.
I am very happy to see Dr. Mutkavi also on the screen. And there are several questions, and I will probably take the help of Dr. Alok Dhawan, Dr. Mutkavi, and Dr. Ranjana to answer these questions. And many, many thanks for your extraordinarily inspiring talk. And it is really important to increase our Atmanirbharata, where our Honorable Prime Minister has mentioned. And CSIR, we are all proud to be working. And the range of questions that were there by the students and the way you have answered will probably very, very helpful for everybody to work with a lot more motivation, sir. Thank you very much on behalf of all of us, because I know that you have a meeting and there are a large number of questions. And as advised by you, we will try to take, and in your absence, I will ask Dr. Alok to lead this question answers along with Dr. Mutkavi and Dr. Ranjana and all others. And we really are very much inspired, and especially your lecture and the answers that you have given is very good for all of us, not only in CSIR and outside CSIR. And the next question is, as our institutes okay. and our Mr. colleges Shastri, are...
I will leave now. Thank you so much. All the best to all the students. And wish you a great successful program. Thank you. Thank you, Alok.
Very much.
Thank you, Ranjana. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. So now I will request Professor Alok Dhawan to answer this question. So the question is, as our institutes and our colleges are closed, online classes are helpful for theoretical knowledge, but how do practicals without going in the labs? Sir, please tell on this.
I think
Professor Dhawan.
Very valid question that the student has raised. I think all of us are struggling with the fact that, especially the universities and the colleges where the labs are closed and the colleges are closed, how does one do the experiment? I think what we are leading ourselves into is a new paradigm where we'd like to see how new equipment should be designed in the future that they can have access from your home or from places which are distant away from there. I think that's the new paradigm that's going to come in. For the students, how we have designed these the training program is that we will be beaming live videos for you, so that you can see very highly sophisticated equipment sitting at home and try to understand how these equipments work. We also have a program wherein we'll try to see how you can collect samples in your surrounding areas, let's say soil samples or water samples, and can we do some experiments with those. I think these are the new paradigms that CSIR will be getting into to ensure that you get a lab-like feeling. I won't say a lab feeling because you'll not be entering the lab, but a lab-like feeling, the most, I think, what they call virtual reality. So you'll be closest to reality, but through your own mobile phone or your laptop or your computer. So I think that's how I perceive this going forward.
So Ankita has a question that what is the last question was asked by Madhav, and Ankita's question is, what is the role of spike protein of coronavirus?
Ankita, these are proteins that actually interact with the human cell, and they allow the virus to actually get attached to the, like Dr. Mandi just mentioned, attached to the human cell, and then they move inside and start replicating. That's the role primarily of these proteins.
Actually, Ankita, if you see, there are drugs which are acting against the virus, and there are drugs which will improve the immunity. And what is very important is to have this host-pathogen interaction, where you have a human host and this pathogen is the virus. And we will have to mimic how this virus will interact with the human cells. And the spike protein is on the periphery. And their interaction will be very important. And there is a question by Shiva Rao. There are many people who are found to be COVID positive even after they are tested negative twice. What is the reason?
What is it?
Shiva's question is, there are some people who were found to be COVID positive. Before that, for two times, they were tested negative.
Yeah, so I think there is a lag before the virus actually shows up in the test. And so therefore, people are now saying that it could be anywhere between 5 to 7 days before you actually see the viral load. So essentially, any test has its own sort of sensitivity. So for the RT-PCR test, you need a certain viral load before you can actually see the or you can actually amplify the DNA and then be able to detect that the virus is present. So I think that's how it is assessed. So people who are negative turn positive after a while, because that's when the viral load in the body actually comes to a point where it can be detected.
So Karan has a question. Is it possible to defest, or he meant to disinfect coronavirus by radiations of daily use light as far as technology developed? I can take this question. Please go ahead.
Go ahead. Who wants to?
I mean, Ranjana, do you want to start? Yeah. Actually, there is a publication about last week in Journal of Materials Chemistry, where this natural sunlight will be a good disinfectant, but it has to be put in that sunlight for about 6.8 minutes, and that will be the challenge. Yes.
I would like to add here.
Please go ahead, Dr. Anjana.
You know, Karan, there are also studies like on different surfaces, the virus has different survival time. And light, you know, if we are talking of ordinary light in the domestic environment or in the office environment, because the light is not so prominent, so it doesn't work that much. So there is a time. For example, at some surfaces it survives for 48 hours, but at some surfaces it survives at for 72 hours or more than that. So, you know, it's too early at the moment to say like the visible light or the sunlight can be used to defest coronavirus. But definitely UV light is being explored and it is effective. But for sunlight, a direct exposure is needed and for a particular time period. Only then it works. Otherwise, we should not take it as a general, you know, thing, and we should be cautious about it. That's what my say is.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anjana. Please, we may ask a few more questions. But now there is a question to Dr. Mutkavi, and who is the director of our Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning activities in both PhD. And the question is, what is the role of deep learning or AI in corona mitigation? Dr. Mutkavi.
Yeah, one of the things that we can do is actually making projections about the number of cases. And in fact, we have tried that in our own institute using the deep learning techniques. And that seems to catch the patterns of infection, because patterns of infection are very specific to different countries. Take, for example, you know, some of the European countries which are very, population density is very low. There, the infection patterns are different. If you take, for example, very densely populated areas like, you know, in India, like Bombay, Delhi, etc. So there the patterns of infections are very different. Deep learning techniques particularly focus on the patterns, particularly pick out these patterns. And these are the best methods to actually pick these patterns and make a prediction about the possibility of the increase or decrease of the cases. And that, of course, can help a great deal in mitigation of the COVID-19 as a for a policymaker. I was just watching, for example, TV coverage yesterday, how they have actually been able to intervene into the Dharavi in Bombay. So they had different techniques where they were able to, intervene. But this could have been probably modeled using deep learning, let us say. Supposing I could model it, saying that, okay, if this is the intervention I do, what are the outcome? So these kind of simulations can be done very quickly and get a grip on what are the possible policy interventions in deep learning. Apart from that, of course, you can also do, I think, in the molecular dynamics, another thing, can reduce the number of simulations probably. in terms of being able to get to the right molecule faster. Of course, that's not my domain, but that's also certainly one area of application where you can do this.
Thank you very much. And may I ask Professor Ranjana to answer this question that LKV Pawar asked that how can we handle the environmental issues after the pandemic?
This pandemic has given us the positive side on the environment side, environmental aspects as well as the negative. If you think at the on both the issues, after the pandemic, when everything was closed down, lockdown, there was no industrial activity, no commercial activity, no transportation. So, you know, this was the time when we see a clear an atmosphere where the sky was blue, where the air was clean, the water was getting cleaner. So these were very, very positive. Biodiversity was flourishing. So these were the very positive impacts of pandemic which has happened. But at the same time, there are many other issues which we must look very closely, like how much plastic waste is being generated at that time, at this time. If we look at the gloves, we masks and the PPE kits and the swabs we are taking, so lots of plastic is being generated. Similarly, water consumption has increased to a great extent because for the hygiene, sanitization, it is essential. And at this moment, we are not concerned about the water conservation. We are more concerned about the hygiene and the sanitization so that we can combat the corona spread. And how much soap and detergents and hypochlorites and all of the disinfectants we are loading into the water. So, you know, there are all plus and minus sides. So after pandemic, co-COVID period, it's going to be a longer period. Now everybody knows that it's not going to finish very soon. So, you know, we have to be very judicious in our choices. When the economy is opening up, we cannot keep our industries closed and commercial activities closed, transportation closed. So, you know, there has to be a very balanced approach that how do we open up and how do we take care of the environment. So the positive impact which we have achieved due to this pandemic, if we are not cautious, it's not going to stay for longer period. So we'll have to be very judicious. Our policies have to be environmental friendly. We'll have to look for the, you know, technologies which are greener technologies. And as Dr. DG mentioned, we should look for the circular, technologies which are using circular approach. No waste is generated. So there are many parameters, multi-pronged approach we'll have to adopt to protect our environment after pandemic. Thank you.
So Prince has a question that in India, as for now, the recovery rate is higher than the infection rate. How are these people being treated and cured by what process in the absence of a specific cure? The question is
in the absence of specific cure, about the coronavirus, it was from the very beginning, it was said like coronavirus, it's not like if somebody is infected, it's going to always be a very serious kind of condition is there. So more than 80% of the patients who are infected with coronavirus are going to be like mild symptoms, or many of them may be asymptomatic. And then like rest of the people who are having comorbidities or having age-related factors, they are basically going to be the serious patients. And out of those also, only some fraction will have the, where the interventions like ventilation that will be needed. So that's the one thing when we say the recovery rate. The second thing is, I will say, like demography of India, I think is a very positive side for us, because, you know, our generation is quite, in terms of European or American, we are having younger population more, so which are able to tolerate that the corona in a better way, to combat corona better way than the older generation. So that can be another reason that we are having. And third one, it can be our immunity, like we are having stronger immune system. Specifically, you know, in our rural areas, people who are involved in the agriculture and these kind of things, they have, you know, they adapt special immunity, special strength. So these can be some of the reasons that why in India the infection rate, recovery of infection rate is higher as compared to other countries. So these are some of the factors.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
And maybe I will ask one more question that Subharanjan Koham has asked. Can we use nanochemistry against COVID-19?
Yes, I think, you know, nanochemistry, I was listening to DST Secretary Dr. Ashutosh Sharma. So they are also, you know, one technology is being developed where they are trying to bind nanoparticles to RNA so that they, in that case, we don't have to isolate RNA because the nanotechnology, the nanoparticles can bind with RNA specifically and make it, you know, separate. We can separate it easily. They just like precipitate it down. And then that saves the isolation time for the RNA, which is the biggest factor in getting delayed in the subjects. So definitely nanoparticles, nanotechnology can play a very important role. Even in the development of diagnostic kits, etc., it has a definite role to play.
Thank you very much. There were several questions like Amit Novele asked that how the Arava mission helped to grow farming economics. And Rajesh Reddy asked, does the virus transmission depend on the regional climate conditions? And Padmakshi Kokoti asked, is it possible to use serum antibodies from those who have recovered from COVID-19 to treat others? And Shubham More has asked, can COVID-19 infect reptiles and amphibians and other mammals? And Gunend Guha asked if therapeutic approach with RNA technology for COVID-19 vaccination, then what are the initiatives taken by CSIR? And there are questions also like, since the coronavirus is constantly mutating, is it possible to find a stable vaccine by Krishna? And Debraj asked that when we have the full knowledge about the spike protein structure of the coronavirus, then why is the vaccine production being so difficult despite all our efforts? And there are questions by Ankush, Kunika, Faraz Ahmad, Tatagiri, Sengupta, Rajat. We will be answering all the questions. But I would like to answer one question by Akshay Gupta, where he asks, is it possible that after completing this online course, we will be given a chance to come to the respective lab under the same scientists? We have learned through online and can learn experiments through preferring physically or bigger apparatus and machines. All of you, this is just our attempt to connect. And there are no promises. And this is an isolated 2 months course. And everything is possible. It all depends on the mentor and mentee. You are just connecting them. And we don't have any specific mandate because when there is a crisis, we thought in a more spontaneous fashion, how do we help people? So there are a large number of questions about herd immunity or how to boost other types of immunity. This is a big area and we will continue our journey. The journey has just begun and we will have several sessions and how to take this forward. And in all these activities, one person along with many others, Dr. Anjana, Dr. Alok Dhawan, and Dr. Chakravarti, and Professor Sangwan, the director of ACSIR, also played a very important role. And we have a strong support by Professor Vijayadhar Mutkavi, who is an expert in data science, machine learning, and AI. And both of us felt initially that we will make it mostly theoretical with a limited number of people. But with his support and all our support, we have expanded. And I request Professor Mutkavi to give his remarks and summary, and also propose the vote of thanks. So please, Professor Mutkavi, you give your own remarks for some time and close the program. Professor Mutkavi.
Thank you. You can hear me. I hope I am audible, right?
Yes, you are audible. Now I am doing that.
I think it'll tough to give a summary because so much has been said, and I think probably your questions are still flowing in. Okay. So yeah, but like you said, it was conceived as an initially a summer training program for a limited number of people, but the thought process I think was really to connect to a very large number of people, because there are many people are sitting locked down in their homes, and it's always, you know, like good to connect with the community of scientists who are now fighting this pandemic. That's only one aspect, because this pandemic will come and go. But I think the new learning, how we use technology to actually reach out to a very large number of sections of people. Because technology gets cheaper and cheaper. If you remember, the mobile is now available in almost everybody's hands. And when I travel from my office to home, I see very young people with their mobiles taking videos and posting them, right? So that means there is a formidable tool in the hands of the people, especially the young people. And it's our attempt to turn their attention and focus onto developing scientific temper. And these tools are already there in your hands. And it because of the widespread of such tools, I think the future will look at how we connect with people, how we teach them, how we transmit knowledge. And I think there's just one step that CSR has taken. And in that way, I think, you know, it's an experiment for us itself, but I'm quite sure even if, you know, 10% of the people get caught on to the ideas of science, how science works, how science can be used for solving the problems around you. I think that is actually what Dr. Shekhar Mande said, that unless the science is used for human good, it is no science. Okay, right. So I think that's pretty much an important statement which came from Mahatma Gandhi, and then he reiterated that one. And CSIR's mandate is actually that. It's actually that. So to solve problems around you using science and technology. And it cannot be done in isolation by just a few scientists. We are, if you look at, you know, even though we are a very large organization, CSIR is a very large organization, something like 15,000 people. But you compare the 15,000 people with the total population of India. India is 1.3 billion people. And if you really look at, you know, CSIR is one of the largest organizations in the country with only 15,000 scientists, it just doesn't make sense that, you know. So there has to be a community involvement in thinking about science in applications to solving our problems. And I think this experiment actually goes in that direction. That's what I feel. And that's an important step. Okay, so that's my brief remark. But now I'll get down to proposing a word of thanks. It's my pleasant duty to do so. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Shekhar Mande. He's an extremely busy person today because I think, you know, the pandemic has thrown so many challenges, and there are 38 laboratories across India, and getting, you know, like all those innovations, interventions for each and every lab, and putting all together is no mean job or not a small job. And that is something that Dr. Shekhar Mande is doing, and that keeps him extremely busy. But in spite of all that, you know, he has come on today and addressed all the students. I'm very thankful to him, and he took so many questions as well. I'm quite sure in his free time, and if he were to be having a free time, he would probably answer all the questions. I am also very thankful to Dr. Narahari Shastri, because I think he was the one who started all this. Okay, so we have only been, you know, helping him here and there, and this experiment we are hoping that it will work out. And I also would like to thank Dr. Alok Thavan, Dr. Ranjana Agarwal, and Dr. Sangwan, the directors of various laboratories who are actually come together to help us do this. Big thanks to Team NIST, because I think all the young people have gotten together. I think there are some more than 25 people or so who have been working tirelessly. I know that one. Even though we are physically distanced, we are emotionally connected. And I think that's what we want from the students, basically, right? I think that's what we want from the students, emotionally correct with us. So that brings me to thank all the students and the researchers and, you know, like the mentors and the maybe there are out there who have not yet heard about the program. You know, like in a 1.3 billion population, which is much younger compared to many nations, I'm quite sure, you know, many would want to connect, and that's a formidable job. Okay, so I would like to thank all the people who have been with us and hearing this first lecture, curtain raiser, which has actually drawn basically the plan that, you know, CSIR put together to solve this problem. And Dr. Shekhar Mandi mentioned about, you know, some of the gems he talked about what CSIR has done, starting with the Indelible Link, for example. In fact, when the 50th year of anniversary of CSIR, there are 50 gems were portrayed and published across the country. Now we are more than 75 years old, and the gems have been coming out in a much faster rate. And more problems that are thrown at the society, the better equipped we will be if we actually think about science. So thank you very much. Then we can conclude this session. I think Dr. Shastri can probably give a roadmap as to what happens next.
I can.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mutkavi. And now, before I close, I would like to say that we are still planning. And tomorrow and day after, you please join. And we will try our best to see that most of the mentors and mentees are connected. Then we will have some small group. And tomorrow at 2:30, the SERB secretary, Dr. Sandeep, Professor Sandeep Verma, will give a lecture, and these are by the highest body policymakers, and we are approaching also DST secretary, DBT secretary, and ICMR secretaries to give a talk, followed by really eminent people. And we are very sorry that more than 2,000 people were trying to connect and they are not able to connect. So we are ensuring the connectivity. As we mentioned in the opening remarks, once this connectivity is established, we will be able to connect to all the 16,000 students that have registered. And hopefully, next 2 days, please be patient. And we are here to really work with you and enjoy this opportunity. And I really thank all the team of CSIR at national level, CSIR NEEST team who are working tirelessly on this. And all of this will make any sense only if all of you show a lot of enthusiasm. So finally, there are still a large number of questions, extremely intelligent and very good questions, which we would like to answer, but this cannot go on forever. And then these questions will be answered because they are all there, and individually you will get the answers for that. And our team and myself also, we will look into it and then we will answer. Thank you very much, all of you, and have a nice day. And then we will try to put the program on the net and have a fantastic day. Bye.
Shastri.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ranjana. Thank you, Dr.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.